Hello, so today we have quantum mechanics harmonic oscillator problem. We start with time independent Schrödinger equation in one dimension. We write the differential equation for the general potential V and then we substitute harmonic oscillator potential here. Mass of the particle is m, omega is its angular frequency and x is distance from the mean position. And then we redefine constants. There are many constants which appear, so we organize these constants. So beta equal to 2m e by h bar square, alpha equal to m omega by h bar. Then the differential equation becomes second derivative, and then beta minus alpha square x square psi equal to 0. And then again we take a ratio of 2m e by h bar square and so divided by alpha h bar by m omega equal to 2e by h bar omega. So epsilon. So we then we arrive at our differential equation. This is square psi del square plus epsilon square psi equal to 0. And first time it was solved, historically, was solved in this paper in 1926 by Erwin Schrödinger, 1926. Asymptotic behavior, first we have to look at the asymptotic behavior of the solution of this differential equation. Asymptotic behavior means Q is very large. We take a trial, psi infinity means Q goes to infinity. We take a trial and substitute and see that the trial solution indeed satisfies the differential equation. Then for a general Q, the trial solution will be psi Q. This here we have this asymptotic behavior and here is a function of Q. So that would be a trial. So for that we have to take first derivative and second derivative of psi. So here is psi. We take first derivative, second derivative and then substitute in the differential equation. And after substituting we get the differential equation for V. So this looks very much like our Hermite differential equation, but there is a difference. Here we have 2n. So we have to see whether this differential equation will indeed reduce to Hermite differential equation or not. This is a second order differential equation with variable coefficients and it is linear and it is homogeneous. So the standard way is to use a power series, I equal to 0 to infinity, ei q to the power tau. We have to find the value of tau from indicial equations and then we have to find a recurrence relation for this coefficients ai. So to determine the coefficients ai, we need recurrence relation for this ai. We need recurrence relation and to determine this value of tau, we have to use the indicial equation. The power series can be developed around a point x equal to x0. But there should not be any singularity at this x equal to x0. Okay, so for us, we can see that q equal to 0 is an ordinary point. That means these coefficients do not have singularities at q equal to 0. If this doesn't have a singularity, this doesn't have a singularity. So these are q equal to 0 is an ordinary point. For us, x0 is the origin. And the series is convergent in a certain interval, x0 minus h to x0 plus h. Formal proof we get in the differential equation book by E. L. Innes. Okay, so we do substitute it in the differential equation and then we get this, because this is a, there is a second derivative, so I plus tau minus 2 coming from second derivative, and here was the first derivative, but again there was a multiplication with q, because coefficient was 2q, so again we get I plus tau, that means 1 power reduces and then it comes back, because the multiplication of q. And here we have I plus tau, because there was just v. So here 2 powers reduce, here 1 power reduces, but then there is q, and then here there is no reduction of power. So that is what we got, 2 power reduces, and then I plus tau and I plus tau. But then we have to collect the coefficients of I plus tau and equate it to 0. That is the trick of the power series solutions, that we can coefficient, after substituting the trial solution, we can collect coefficients and then we can equate those coefficients to 0. For arbitrary q, the right hand side is 0. This q is arbitrary. That means we can collect powers and equate them separately to 0. So collecting coefficient of rhythm for I plus tau, then we get this. The I plus 2 comes from here, because there, if I want coefficient of I plus tau, I have to substitute I equal to I plus 2. So here I have got the I plus 2, and I plus 2 plus tau, and so I plus 1 plus tau. Okay. And here we have got I plus tau, here we have got epsilon minus 1, EI. So this is 0, that means the ratio becomes AI plus 2 by AI. For large Q, the dominant behavior comes from large values of I. Think about this solution. When Q is large, then higher powers will contribute. Large values of I, that gives us I, 2I from here, and I square from here. So it is 2 by I. Shift's book. So he has considered a closed form function q to the power k to the power q square. And here also the ratio for large q is 1 by I for very large values of I. So we can also say that for large values of q, the solution will behave as q to the power k to the power q square. This argument by Schiff, q to the power k to the power q square. If we take all the terms in q, then vq will behave as q to the power k e to the power q square for large values of q. Q goes to infinity, it will diverge, that means the solution will diverge for large q. Psi will behave as e to the power minus q square by 2 multiplied by this e to the power q square, e to the power q square, then q to the power k. Which would behave as q to the power k e to the power plus q square by 2. So this will diverge. That means consequently we see that psi q, which is product of vq and to the power minus q square by 2, cannot be asymptotically well behaved if vq is not truncated to a polynomial. And what about indicial equations? Indicial equations will be found by collecting coefficients of the lower coefficients. For I equal to 0, we will get q to the power tau minus 2, and for I equal to 1, we will get q to the power tau minus 1, and those powers are absent here. Here the series starts from tau, q to the power tau, simply starts from q to the power tau, because I equal to 0. But here the series starts from tau minus 2, then tau minus 1. So we can collect these powers, tau minus 2, tau minus 1, and equate them to 0, and which gives us two equations. I equal to 0 in which is 1. This we will get from I. I equal to 1. Okay, so which one is it? Is 1? This one. So these initial equations give two cases, one for tau equal to 0, this gives solutions at tau equal to 0 and tau equal to 1. So for tau equal to 0, A0 is not equal to 0, and A1 is arbitrary, because tau equal to 0, A1 is arbitrary. And for tau equal to 1, A0 is non-zero. And A1 is 0, tau equal to 1, so that is 2, A1 is 0, so A1 is 0. So in case 1, the odd series will be present, and case 2, odd series will be not be present. Mathematically, in case 1, odd series will be present, but from physical arguments, from square integrability, we will find that even for case 1, the odd series, we can get rid of the odd series from physical arguments in case 1, and in case 2 odd series is not there even from just from the beginning. Okay, so tau equal to 0 case will be truncated if from the, we will see the truncation condition from here. Here is 3 minus epsilon plus 2y equal to 0. When tau equal to 1, and when tau equal to 0, 1 minus epsilon, 2y equal to 0. So two cases are considered separately, and then these two conditions can be joined. So first, tau equal to 0 case and tau equal to 1 case, we will do, and then we can join these two cases. So for tau equal to 0 case, 1 minus epsilon plus 2y equal to 0, I equal to 0 to 4, 6, because we are looking at the even series. So this condition truncates the even series and doesn't do anything for the odd series. Odd series is still there. So, but we will see at the end how to get rid of the odd series, but at this point, this condition truncates the even series, and after truncation we get the truncation condition, because epsilon is 2e by h cross omega, we substitute here, and energy eigenvalues are I plus half h cut omega, but I equal to 0 to 4 6, even values of I. That means this first series, even series, has now become a polynomial, and we have got eigenvalues. The odd series is still infinite series, but because I q must be square integrable, infinite part must vanish. This comes from physics. This argument is a physics argument. This is a physics argument. Mathematically, they should be there, infinite series, but by demanding the square integrability condition, minus infinity plus infinity psi squared dx equal to 1, this infinite series vanishes, which gives E1 equal to 0 for the case tau equal to 0. Next is the even tau equal to 1 case. Tau equal to 1 case, of course, we have 3 minus epsilon plus 2 equal to 0 and I equal to 0 to 4 6. This is important, 0 to 4 6. So this condition gives E I equal to I 3 by 2 h plus 2 omega I equal to 0 to 4 6. And here the odd series is not there. So we have only a truncated even series. So this is much simpler. Only a truncated even series, no odd series, and these are energy eigenvalues. Now you can join tau equal to 0 case and tau equal to 1 case. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, all values of I, all integral values of I. Then these two conditions can be joined. And then En equal to n plus half h cut omega for all values of I. Okay. So for tau equal to 0 case and tau equal to 1 case can be written together as En equal to n plus half h cut omega I equal to this. Not the even values of I, but 0, 1, 2, 3, all values of I. So here we join these two cases, and this is the eigenvalues of harmonic oscillator. So these are the eigenvalues of harmonic. Then these are the eigenvalues, these are the eigenfunctions, A0 and then A0, A to Q square. So this is the even series, remember even series, and this is also even series, but here the even series is multiplied because tau equal to 1, and then we have the series, tau equal to 1. So from here we have got this cube. This is again the even series, A0, odd series has vanished from the physics. And this is again even series, but again tau equal to 1 case. So that gives extra Q. Even series with an extra Q. This is even series, and this is again the even series with an extra Q. So this and this and this, these three has come from tau equal to 1, and this have come from tau equal to 0. This is come from tau equal to 0. So let us mark, this is the tau equal to 0 case, tau equal to 0, tau equal to 0, tau equal to 1, tau equal to 1, tau equal to 1. Similarly here, this has come from tau equal to 0, tau equal to 0, tau equal to 0, and these are from tau equal to 1, tau equal to 1, tau equal to 1. So we have joined tau equal to 0 case and tau equal to 1 case. Then we have written it in a compact form. So that is a harmonic oscillator eigenvalues. Eigenfunctions can be now found with a very elegant way. You see E, that is 2E equal to 2N plus 1 h cut omega, or 2E by h cut omega equal to 2n plus 1, this is epsilon, so epsilon minus 1 equal to 2n, epsilon minus 1 equal to 2n, and that is what we are seeking all the way. Okay, so epsilon minus 1 equal to 2n, and then we have the Hermite's differential equation, which has a standard solution, Hermite solution. Now the wave functions can be written as there is a part coming from the Hermite's polynomial, and then this is the coming from the asymptotic behavior, and here is the normalization. Now this normalization can be found. Let's find the normalization. Let us find consider one case, psi 2 square. Psi 2 square we can easily find 0 to infinity. This is from q4 term, q square term and 1 term. Okay, because Hermite polynomial h2 Hermite polynomial will give me 4 q square minus 2. Then we have 2 whole square. So q to the power 4 q square. And there is a term q to the power 0 term. So all these three terms, this q to the power 0 term, q square term, q4 term, and then substitute the Gaussian integrals and find out the normalization. This is for 2. Like that you can calculate the normalizations of all these. Okay, so why a harmonic oscillator potential is so important? It is because if you take any potential and if you do Taylor expansion, then near the minimum this will vanish. Near the minimum, if you look near the minimum, then near the minimum this will vanish, and you can shift the minimum. This is a constant term. So constant term, you can shift the minimum, and then this is 0, this is 0. So the first significant term is this x squared term. And this is a constant, second derivative at x equal to 0. That means if you take any potential and expand around the minimum, it looks like a harmonic oscillator. So that is the significance of the harmonic oscillator potential. And finally, you know, some references. These are online references, and here are the books. And this book gives a historical development of the quantum mechanics. B. L. van der Waarden. This gives a collection of papers, initial papers translated to English. And I have used this book and Schiff's book and all these books. So I hope that this will be useful for you, because the harmonic oscillator is a very important topic in quantum mechanics. So thank you for watching.